of these nights, and about 12 o'clock, this old bird's gonna demand rock. Saints, we all tremble and cry for pain, for the Lord's gonna come in his heaven airplane.
Okay, so we are we're now on the banks of the Sepik River in a town called Angoram. And the Sepik is a huge river. It's as important to Papua New Guinea as the Congo is to Africa, or the Amazon is to South America, or the Mississippi is to the United States. It carries commerce and provides fish for the people and water, and I mean, it's just everything to the people who live here. This couple tens of thousands of people living along this river in dozens and dozens of villages. And one of the things it's very well known for is the carving skills of the people who live here. And this is a typical workshop of a man who's both an artist and a river guide. And you see some of the variety of things that are produced on the river. Sepik River is famous for this artwork that gets shipped to museums and art collectors and galleries all over the world. You find them in New York and Munich and London and Paris. Angoram is near the bottom of the river, near the mouth of the river, and because of that, you see artwork that has been produced in all other parts of the river too. In other words, a lot of it finds its way to Angoram, where it is then sold to traders and people like that. So in addition to the peculiar styles found that, let's say, are original to this particular village, Angoram also has art from around the Sepik, and also a lot of craftsmen, artists who can duplicate the styles of stuff from all up and down the river. And as you can see in this place, the variety of things is incredible. So I'm going to be traveling with this man, who is Francis. Francis is the son of somebody I made the acquaintance of in the coastal town of Wewak, and the two of us are going to be spending some time together. So that's what you're going to be seeing in the days ahead. So, what do you say we hit the river? Water that moves through it. Right now it's the dry season,
I don't know, half mile wide, but in the rainy season, the banks flood right over the top, and this river can spread out 3 or 4 miles wide. The amount of water coming down from the mountains from here means it's a very deep river. During the dry season, there's a lot of water moving through here. There's no delta at the end of it where it meets the ocean, so the water just shoots straight out into the Pacific. And I've been told by people who should know what they're talking about that you can dunk a bucket into the ocean 50 miles out off the coast of the island and still get fresh water to drink. So it's a pretty impressive spot, and there's a lot of people living along it, but they're spread out. So you have these huge areas where there's no settlements, and the water is safe enough to drink for most of it. What's going on here, all right, is we ran into a party of really art buyers, okay? This fellow, one of these guys, his name is Cletus, he's Jeffrey's dad, and I traveled with them in 94. All right, all? See you later. And we just ran into them right on the river there with canoes loaded full of old house posts. These things are going to be sold in the international market, you know, they dismantle these houses and, you know, art collectors go crazy for this stuff. And so it was real cool. We ran into a lot of people that I saw from 94, and they caught, you know, these guys all caught up on who's going where and everything, but it was fun for me to kind of see everybody. So off we go again. Up a jungle stream like this with a bunch of friends, eating fresh picked bananas and soaking in the sunshine. We've
We've arrived at our first real destination. This is the village of Kanduanum. And see what happens from here. You know, for an American, it really is hot in this country. It's very warm, but if you will just find a nice shady place like this house and stop doing so much stuff in the middle of the day, it's cool and breezy, and you could really learn to love it. The news that truly shocks is the You know, I realize that there are health issues and education issues and human welfare issues in a place like this. And it's real easy to come as a tourist and say how idyllic the setting is and how you just like to stay here forever and live this way. And of course, there's got to be a lot more to this life than meets the eye. The way I'm presenting it, you know. And yet there is something poetic in the lifestyle that lends itself better to moving pictures like this than it does to me trying to put it into words. And coming back here after 10 years, I realize really just how much I've missed this whole sort of existence. I won't stand here and try to tell you that it's less than voluntary, you know. As an American, I can stay here as long as I want to, and if I get sick, I can leave the country and go to the best hospital in the world. If I get in some kind of trouble, you know, I have all the aid available to me, and these people don't. But there's something grounding about staying in this place, if just for a little while, and getting back in touch with what it's like to live with the most basic of needs.